Okay, good morning. So let's get started from where we left last time, and we were just starting to discuss about real-time communication over a packet switched network. So we had seen over LAN, and now we'll see how real-time communication can be achieved in a wide area network environment. So let's continue from there. So we know that the wide area networks are based on packet switching. And a popular example is the internet, very widely used. And we also know that internet provides best effort service, does not distinguish between the sources, and for every source it tries to utilize the resources and provide the best service. Okay, it does not distinguish among applications, and as a result it also does not guarantee timeliness or actual delivery to intended recipients. And it just does the best that is possible. But on the other hand, we see that the commercial usage of internet based real time applications is increasing every day. We are doing online banking transaction, video conferencing, VoIP, and so on. So in that context, let's see how real-time communication can be achieved over the internet or any wide area network. So first, let's understand the basic model of the internet. Here, the sender and receiver are connected to each other through various links and routers that are in between. And if we look at the internet, there are three types of routers. The edge routers, which handle the requests from the sender and also connect to the receiver. So depending on whether they are handling the sender or the receiver, it's ingress or egress type. And then the core routers, which are in between. And various types of physical media is used over different links. For example, some may be twisted pair, fiber optic, wireless, and so on. So if we look at this basic model, we'll see that the host is connected to the ingress router, and then that the core routers, and then the egress router connects to the receiver. Now let's see how the real-time requirements of applications can be met in the internet environment. To support real-time traffic, of course, there has to be some preferential treatment given to the real-time traffic, because if it does not distinguish between the traffic sources, then it cannot give any guarantee, real-time guarantee. So what it finally turns out that the sender needs to communicate or need to identify its traffic needs, the kind of traffic, the characteristics, and the quality of service requirement, and the network on the other hand needs to agree to this. The service provider needs to agree to this, and once this contract between the sender and the ISP is agreed upon, then the ISP would ensure that the required quality of service for the given traffic source will be met. So that's the basic way in which it will work. So the ISP would somehow ensure the quality of service guarantee. We'll look at that, how it can do that. But at the same time, we must remember that the sender node needs to meet the bounds of the traffic for which the quality of service was agreed upon. If it pumps in a different traffic or a traffic having different characteristics than what was agreed upon, then of course it would be difficult to meet the required quality of service, not only for this source but even for the other source, other connections. So it becomes very important before the real-time communication, how it is handled, we discuss. Let's try to address how a traffic source can be characterized so that for a given traffic source, the agreement between the ISP and the sender can be obtained. And if in case a sender has agreed upon some traffic characteristics and then it misbehaves, it pumps in more traffic or traffic having a different characteristic, it had agreed for a CBR traffic and then it just generates a bursty traffic, then it will inconvenience or it will make it difficult to meet the QoS requirements for the other applications also. So the ISP should be able to handle the misbehaving nodes and possibly it can restrict their traffic or even may reject a source. To guarantee the quality of service requirements, we will see that one main technique that is used is traffic shaping and policing. One is shaping traffic, it can even police the traffic. So let's see what is traffic shaping. So in traffic shaping, the network will change the characteristics of the traffic. If it is a bursty traffic, too much of bursts are there, it can smoothen out. For example, the way it might do it is that by adopting suitable scheduling policies at the switches. So even though the packets are generated too rapidly by the source, it might queue them and only generate a CBR traffic or maybe a traffic characteristic that was agreed upon, right? So that is the traffic shaping. The shape of the traffic that was given by the source was not acceptable and therefore the network might shape the traffic, reshape, and even this can occur at the different routers because the traffic from different sources arise there and it may be that the combined effect of different sources distort the shape of the traffic that was originally generated. So it might reshape the traffic, right, using certain scheduling techniques.
Sir, is it possible that the traffic from misbehaving node can be rejected also? Or it will be shaped and then accepted?
Yes. See, one is that traffic shaping, right? A shaping does not involve rejecting the source. It's trying to make the best that it can do to make the traffic into the desired characteristics, not only at the sender end, but also in the intermediate routers, right? Here rejection is not considered, but in policing, where it checks whether the traffic that was given by the source is not of the required characteristics, it can be also rejected. So in policing, the network controls the input rate at the connections. We will see that this is part of the modern quality of service architecture for the internet, where real-time transactions can be done. Now, let's look at the way it is done in the modern internet. We will discuss about the int serve and the diff serve, which are used for providing quality of service to the receivers and the sender, the connections basically. Now, the first thing we need to discuss is about how do we characterize the traffic, because based on this, the sender and the ISP, right? So let's look at the traffic characterizations. So during the call initiation, the sender needs to specify the traffic characteristics, and the network in turn will do an admission control, that is, it will check whether the given traffic characteristic can be given the required quality of service that is being demanded by the source. So the admission control will be carried out at the call initiation based on the traffic characteristics. So once it finds that it can support the specified traffic for the given quality of service requirement, the ISP would agree to the application that the required quality of service for the specified traffic can be given. And we'll see that the main way in which the traffic is characterized is by bounding the volume of data per unit time. What is the maximum data that can be transmitted per unit time? But if we say that just bound the maximum data rate, it's not really a correct statement, because for bursty traffic, if we just bound the data rate, it will lead to unnecessary resource reservation, which are wasted most of the time, because the bursts occur once in a while, isn't it? So you need a more accurate characterization of the traffic. And if we are able to accurately specify the traffic that is bound on the data that is being generated by the source, then it will reduce the resource that needs to be reserved. Otherwise, conservatively, too much resource might have to be reserved for bursty traffic. So by accurately specifying the traffic, we can reduce the amount of resource that needs to be reserved for a specific connection. And it will increase the improve the network utilization and also help to reduce resource idling. So characterization, traffic characterization is a very important point in specifying the traffic to the ISP. Many models exist for traffic characterization which are being used, and these different models are suitable for different types of traffic. So let's look at the simplest model, the X-min S-max model. A traffic would satisfy this model if the inter-arrival times between two packets is always less than X-min. And size of the largest packet does not exceed S-max. It would provide a tight bound for CBR traffic. There is a mistake here actually. The inter-arrival time between two packets is always greater than X-min. Okay, X-min is the minimum difference between the arrival of two packets. This is the minimum separation. It won't arrive any sooner than X-min. If it arrived one packet, the next one, there must be X-min separation. In other words, if there are bursts where too much of data gets generated, then of course, X-min would may be less than the one that is specified, and this won't be appropriate model. Similarly, the S-max is the size of the largest packet would be S-max, and the packet size will always be less than S-max. Here the inter-arrival time will be more than X-min. This is the, and the size will be less than S-max, right? So if we look at it, then it can actually model a constant bit rate traffic. It can provide a tight bound to the CBR traffic, because here these two parameters are enough, because S-max is always a constant and X-min is also a constant. So by the X-min S-max specification, we can, for any interval, we can tell what is the maximum traffic that's arising at that, and accordingly resource reservation can be made. Now let's look at the R, T model. this model, the traffic would satisfy the model if it generates no more than r into t bits over any interval t. Just look at this, any interval t. So, let me just emphasize this. Over any interval t. So, that means t can be large or t can be small, but still r into t bits will be generated. In other words, r is the maximum rate at which data will be generated in any instant, right? Is that clear? So, this is again a good model for CBR traffic, but for bursted traffic, it will make a very conservative, we'll have to specify a very conservative value of r, right? That is the maximum data rate or the maximum burst that can occur, data burst, and then the resource has to be reserved according to that. It does not tell about the average data rate, is not it? So, for a CBR traffic, it would work well and resource reservation can be made. But for a bursty traffic like this, where there can be burst, it will lead to reserving resources at the maximum rate. Okay? So, it is not a good model for bursty traffic, but for CBR traffic, it is all right. Now, let us look at another model, the X min, X average, S max and I model. We will say that a connection would satisfy this model if it satisfies the X mean S max model. So, this specifies what? The X mean S max specifies what? Yes? Can anybody answer? What does X mean S max specify? It is the maximum rate at which data will be generated, right? The X min S max model specifies the maximum rate at which data is generated. And we had said that if the maximum rate is equal to the average rate, then this is a good model. But for a bursted traffic, the maximum rate will be much higher than the average rate. So, we need to also characterize the average rate of data generation. Now, let us see how this model specifies the average rate of data generation. So, a connection would satisfy this model if we specify its maximum data rate through the X mean S max, X mean and S max parameters, and also the X average and I parameters will specify over any interval I, what is the average inter-arrival time? See, X min is the minimum inter-arrival time, right? X average is the average inter-arrival time. So, this would specify the average rate of data, is not it? So, the other model, we could only specify the maximum rate here. Even these two parameters, the X mean S max, they specify the maximum rate at which data is being generated. And we have the second parameter, the X average and I, which will specify the average rate, maybe this one, maybe somewhere here, right? So, we are bounding it by the maximum rate and the average rate. Is that okay? So, this would be a better characterization of a bursty traffic, even though it is not really an accurate approximation or an accurate characterization of bursty traffic. Why is that? Why it is not an accurate characterization of bursty traffic? Yes? No, we are specifying both the maximum and the average, but still it is not a good characterization of bursted traffic.
But the period for which we have voltage only.
Yes.
For that rate, that burst may not be the same as we would have expected. Burst is
okay.
It may not be periodic.
Yeah. Okay. So it basically. So what? As he says, that it basically gives two information. What is the average rate at which data will be generated, and what is the peak rate at which data will be generated? But how frequently the peaks will occur, or what will be the sizes of the peaks in different instances, it does not tell anything regarding that. So let's see the different models. Another model. Okay, so whatever we discussed is again here. So it bounds the peak and the average rate of the traffic. The peak rate is S max by X min, as we are saying, and the average rate is S max by X average. So, where an average interval of X average, S max is getting generated, right? X average is the average separation between two packets. It definitely provides a more accurate bound for VBR traffic than the X min S max model, but still it is not really a good characterization of burst traffic, where bursts of different sizes can occur. Now let us look at the sigma comma rho model. A connection would satisfy this model if during any interval t, so again mark this one, any interval t. So, that is up to us, whatever we consider. The number of bits generated by the connection is less than sigma plus rho into t. So, what does this give us? If we say that over any interval it should be less than this, what will it give us?
Minimum value plus data rho into t.
That's okay, but what does this total expression give? This is the maximum number of bits that are generated, because any interval, no? So it will you can include the largest burst that exists. So it is sigma plus rho into t is the maximum rate at which data will be generated. Right? We'll see. So this model can can model burst traffic, because sigma is the average rate, and rho into t will specify the maximum burst that can occur over the average. Over the averages, not the burst size, but the increase in data rate over the average rate. Do you agree to that? Because we are saying that this is the maximum rate, and rho is the average rate, and sigma is the average rate, and rho into t will give this one, right? Isn't it? The increase over the average rate in a burst. Are you agreeing to that, or yes or no? The sigma is the average value. So, what is the average at which it will be generated? Okay. And the rho into t is the maximum data that can occur over the average rate. Is that okay? Okay. Now, let us look at if the traffic is really, the resource reservation is really crucial to give a exact characterization of the traffic, burst traffic. We can bound the rate of a burst traffic over multiple bounding intervals. So, you can bound the traffic, over multiple averaging intervals. And the traffic would satisfy the multiple rate bounding if we specify several R1, T1. We had discussed about the R, T model, right? So, we specify several bounding intervals where T1 is less than T2, T3, etc. So, over any interval I, the number of bits generated will be less than Ri into Ti, where I is between Ti minus 1 and Ti. So, you just give me any interval, whether you tell 5 seconds or 3 seconds or some milliseconds, I can tell you what is the maximum rate data will be generated over that. I will just look at the corresponding Ti minus and Ti, and then I will take Ti and I will say that, see, the data rate will be between Ri into Ti and Ri into Ti minus 1, isn't it? So, here the different sized bursts can be modeled, isn't it? But of course, needs many parameters and more complicated. So, unnecessarily we won't use it unless it is really required.
So, this interval will be divided for how long?
That depends, yeah. So, just look at the question. The question is that for how many bounds we have to give, how many TI? So, the answer to that is that it depends on the type of traffic that we are trying to model, the different bursts that might exist. So, if the burst is unpredictable, bursts can be of any size, then we will have to use many TIs. We can't really say how many TIs, right? Large number of TIs. But if we know that the bursts can be two or three types, if the bursts are of two or three types, sometimes a burst of 3 packets per 10 millisecond can occur, sometime it can be 10 packets per 2 millisecond, etc. So, then we can specify those bounding intervals, right? But if nothing can be said about the traffic, it would become extremely difficult to model that traffic. So, one thing to notice here is that as the averaging interval gets longer, that is T1, T2, Ti, etc., as Ti becomes longer and longer, the source is bounded by a rate which is lower than the peak rate but closer to the long term average. The peak rate will occur when we are considering the smallest Ti, isn't it? The smallest interval over which we are specifying the traffic, that will tell us about the peak rate. And as the bounding interval increases, it will come closer and closer to the long term average. So, for this kind of traffic, let us say we have few burst sizes, then we can specify for those bounding intervals, and that will give us a exact characterization of this kind of traffic. Now, we have discussed about how traffic can be modeled, right. Now, let us see, once the source specifies the traffic model and its quality of service requirement, what does the network do to check whether it can accept the request and how it will ensure that the quality of service demand will be met? Let us proceed with that. So, that we will call as the quality of service framework. So, this is what the network will do to honor or not to honor the request of the source, and then having honored, what it will do to meet the demanded quality of service. The quality of service framework would consist of the following component. One is routing. Routing is a important component in providing the required quality of service. Call admission control, it will check whether at all for the specified traffic the requested quality of service can be delivered. Rate control, what if the traffic after having requested a rate it misbehaves, so need to control the rate. The service discipline is as the rate has been agreed upon, through the intermediate routers, at what rate it will be serviced. The service discipline will check how to the queued traffic, how it will be transmitted, right, at the intermediate nodes, the intermediate routers. And then the quality of service renegotiation, because sometimes the traffic, the source might generate large amount of data than what was planned, and it will try to renegotiate the quality of service, or maybe it does not generate traffic at that rate anymore, at least for some time, then it will try to renegotiate the quality of service, and it might change its traffic characteristic, it might change its quality of service requirement. So that is the quality of service renegotiation. So if we look at the different routers, so this is a core router, and even at the edge routers, we will have these components there, which handle the quality of service requirement. So one is routing. The call admission control, this is not really required at the core. The service discipline, see the rate control, it generates the traffic that needs to be transmitted, and the service discipline, as I was saying, it will schedule the traffic to be transmitted on the link, on the outgoing link. And then the quality of service renegotiation component, which will handle any requests for renegotiating the agreed quality of service and the traffic. So first, let's look at the call admission control. We will discuss this in slightly more detail as we proceed, but let's have the overall idea. In call admission control, you need to test whether the required resources are available to meet the demand. And if the required resources are available to meet the quality of service demand for the specified traffic characteristic, then the call establishment will be carried out. But what do we mean by call establishment? In call establishment, the required resources will be reserved at the various routers. And then finally, the call termination, when the call is over, it is turned down. What it really means is that the resources are de-reserved. So these are the important tasks that will be carried out by the call admission control module. And let's look at the rate control and the service modules. The rate control module will ensure that the source does not violate the agreed upon traffic rate. And we are saying that there are different ways it can be handled. One is by traffic shaping, where even if the traffic that is being generated is not of the agreed upon shape, it will try to reshape. And then the policing and control. And one thing that we will, as we proceed, will observe is that as the traffic proceeds through the network, it becomes burstier and burstier through the different routers. A traffic which was bursty to a very small extent, as it proceeds through the network, it will become burstier and burstier. Why is that? Anybody can? Exactly. So he has the answer that it will get stored at different routers, and then it will be transmitted at the peak rate, and then at some time there will be no traffic. So as it proceeds through the network, a traffic which was only to a very small extent bursty, it will become burstier and burstier, and therefore traffic shaping will be needed at the intermediate routers. The service discipline, it will check the reservations that were made by the during channel establishment, the resource reservations that were made for a specific connection, and then it will take up the queued traffic from different sources, and then it will transmit at that rate. So it will schedule the packets that were queued up at the agreed upon rates. Right? These were the reservations made. For example, let's say bandwidth may be reserved. So it will, the service discipline will ensure that the intermediate routers where reservations are made, the traffic, the queued up traffic will be transmitted based on the bandwidth reserved. Now let's look at the quality of service renegotiation. A renegotiation request can come from a connection which would like to change its requirement regarding the traffic or the quality of service requirement, or it can be from the network due to overload and congestion, that suddenly there is too much of load on the network, or maybe some links failed. It might try to renegotiate the quality of service with the application. So if we look at this whole picture, we'll have different core routers here, hundreds or thousands of them in the internet, and then there is the edge routers, the incoming traffic handled by the ingress router, the source. It first requests the connection, routing and call admission control takes place, and then it gives the traffic subject to rate control and then the service discipline. And as it gets forwarded to different core routers, it again undergoes rate control and the service discipline, and finally it reaches the destination, and the destination can even make quality of service renegotiation. We'll just look at this in the context of multicast routing. Now let's look at routing. We had said that packet routing is a very important means by which quality of service guarantees can be given to applications. During routing, we know that the route selection takes place, and the route selection takes place during the connection establishment. For both unicast and multicast routings that we will consider now. But one thing is that the routing algorithms that are used in the traditional protocols, they consider the shortest path routing. They optimize with respect to the number of hops in the route selection. But we will see that this is not really appropriate for a real-time request, because here shortest path is not really the only criterion. Here there are several quality of service criteria, and it needs to meet all those, not just the shortest path. So if we use a traditional protocol, we will observe that it would route packets over paths that are unable to meet the quality of service requirements, even though there might exist some path where it might have been possible to provide the quality of service requirement. So, if we are trying to consider quality of service during routing, which we will call as QoS routing, the traditional routing will just refer as routing, and when we need to consider the various quality of service parameters, we will call it as the QoS routing. In QoS routing, the algorithms need to be optimized with respect to the other metrics which will help ensure the required quality of service. So, we will sometimes call it as constraint based routing or quality of service routing. Let's look at the quality of service routing. Here, the primary goal is to select a route route that will meet the quality of service requirement of a connection. So it needs to consider what quality of service requests were made during the connection establishment, and then it will select a path that will meet all the quality of service requirement for the specified traffic, subject to increasing network utilization. It's not just finding any path that will meet the quality of service requirement, but also it has to ensure that the load is in the network is balanced, and it will increase the network utilization. Of course, the quality of service routing, just like the traditional routing, needs to consider the topology of the network in addition to the quality of service requirement. And then it has to consider the various requirement and the availability resources at the links and so on. The complexity, there are several algorithms actually exist for QoS routing. But the complexity of a quality of service routing algorithm would depend on what kind of quality of service the application requires, the specific constraints. The different quality of service requirements may be hop count, delay, bandwidth, delay jitter, etc. Now we will try to classify the different constraints, quality of service constraints, into three main types. Whatever quality of service constraints we had discussed so far, let's try to classify them depending on whether it is easy to or difficult to meet the constraint and what are the general characteristic of the constraint. Now let's say Dij is a constraint for a link ij. So if that is the case, the Dij is a constraint between a link ij, then we can have one class of constraint is a additive constraint. In an additive constraint, if there is a path consisting of many links ij, j, j plus 1, lm, etc., then the quality of constraint for the entire path will be a summation of the quality of constraint for the individual paths. Is that okay? So we have some quality of service requirement for the connection as a whole. We can split that into quality of service requirements on the individual links. Now, what are examples of this? End-to-end delay. So, if we need some end-to-end delay, we can split the end-to-end delay between various links. Jitter. So, what is the maximum jitter that will be permitted? We can split the jitter also. Cost, hop count, etc. These can be split. So, these are all examples of additive constraints. There can be multiplicative constraints. So, here the constraint and the entire path will be expressed as a multiplication of the constraints and the individual links. What is an example of this? Reliability. So, if we have a reliability on the entire path, then we need to multiply the reliability of the individual links in the path. Now, we have some constraints which are concave type, concave constraints. In the concave constraint, the constraint on the entire path is actually a minimum of the constraints on the individual paths. So, we don't bother what is the maximum that can be provided by a link. Our constraint will be guided by the minimum that is available in any of the links. What is an example? Bandwidth. So, even if in some of the intermediate links too much of bandwidth is available, but as far as the constraint on the path is concerned, the minimum bandwidth is what we will consider.
Sir, why is it called concave constraint?
Concave because we are considering the minimum that is available. If it was a maximum that we are considering, that will be a convex constraint. So concave, we can think of that if the bandwidth on different links that's available is, let's say, is like this. So we need to consider the minimum here. But in a convex, we'll consider the maximum that is available in any of the links, and we'll say that the path constant is the maximum that is available. We don't have an example of a convex constant, none of the quality of constants that we discussed. So we did not discuss about a convex constant.
Does it exist?
No, convex constant is hard to think of anything. In the current quality of service that we discussed, the different QoS parameters, these will fall into any of these three. But I don't know, in future there might be new quality of service requirements which might satisfy convex, but at the moment there are no convex constraints. Delay is additive constant. And it is an established result reported by Wang and Crawford that the problem of finding a path or a route subject to two or more additive or multiplicative constraints is NP complete. So, this is an important result, that it is a difficult problem if we have two or more additive or multiplicative constants. Very hard to satisfy this, because concave constant we just take the minimum, that's all. But one thing is that the, if you look at that result, the proof of the NP completeness assumes that the constraints that we are considering are independent. That's one assumption that's made in the NP completeness proof. But in our situation, that's not the case. See, if it, we were trying to establish this result in the context of a circuit switched network, this would be true, because the different paths are independent here, right? But we are considering a packet switched path, a packet switched link, and it's not true actually for a packet switched link. And the other assumption is that the delay and jitter link are known a priori, but here we know that these are related constant. The delay and jitter are not really independent parameters. The delay, bandwidth, jitter, these are related. So these are not independent really, but these are related. So possibly I should have written this point under this one. So, the constraints are not really independent, because if you delay and bandwidth, for example, they are interrelated, isn't it? If you have more bandwidth, the delay will be less. Similarly, the jitter is also affected by these parameters. But even then, even though the result that was established is not strictly true for the case that we are considering for a packet switch network, but still it indicates that it would be hard to develop a optimal algorithm, efficient optimal algorithm for quality of service routing. We know that in a traditional network we have polynomial algorithms like Bellman, Ford, Dijkstra's, etc., which are based on hop count, delay, jitter, etc. We can't really make straight away use this, need different algorithms. But one thing that we must keep in mind is that out of the different constraints, the bandwidth and hop count are important. The others are dependent on this, because if we know bandwidth, we can also tell about delay. Right, and this is also easier to handle in a network during the quality of service establishment and so on. So that's what it says, that delay and jitter are influenced by bandwidth and hop count, and bandwidth is a parameter that is easily controlled. Even for the service discipline, if bandwidth we specify, it can be easily enforced, and it's considered as an essential constant for all real-time application. And also the hop count determines resource utilization. One thing that we must consider is the multicast routing, because whenever we have multimedia applications, multicast routing comes naturally. These are becoming practically important. For example, VoIP, where you have multiple persons participating in a VoIP session. They are doing a conference call using the VoIP, or maybe video on demand, where there is a video server on which different persons are getting the streamed video, right? But they might be using the same video stream, and therefore this would require a multicast routing, because the same source is being shared by different receivers. And in this situation, the one that we discussed about a conference call, about the same source, video source being shared by multiple receivers, if we think of a point-to-point connection between the source and destination pair, for example here, if we establish a point-to-point connection between a source and all the receivers, or here between the different sources and receivers, it will be a extremely inefficient solution. It's impractical actually, because too much of bandwidth, resources, etc. will be wasted, because they share the links in between all these different connections. They share the resources, and we must consider that, and that's the crux of the multicast routing. So unless we use a multicast routing for this kind of application, it will lead to huge resource wastage, and we have to use a multicast tree connection. The essential idea behind the multicast routing is that savings in resources is achieved by sharing, because after all, the same data with same quality of service requirements, etc., is getting transmitted. So it's unnecessary to duplicate them. They should be able to share the same set of resources. We should not handle them as independent sources and receivers. We should handle them together. That's the idea. And even if we consider a VoIP, not all sources are active at the same time, and we must make use of that. So in that context, we need to define a multicast group. A multicast group is a set of routers and links through which the traffic from a set of sources traverse to some common receivers, right? Maybe a single source, a set may be a single source to which it traverse to some receivers, or it may be that the traffic traverses from a few sources to some of the receivers. So basically they are sharing the data. When this source sends, one source sends, it reaches to some of the destinations, and another source also reaches these destinations. The multicast routing algorithms, if we look at it, it basically find a tree that's routed at the source. So if we have multiple sources, we need to have all these trees that are originated at the sources and connect the destinations or the receivers. So the tree should be rooted at the sources and should cover all the receivers. And for simplicity, we can consider a single source where the tree would be rooted at the source and it should cover all the receivers. And every path from the sender to each receiver should satisfy the quality of service constraint. Right? We have to consider all the receivers and the paths that are existing between the sources, and then find that along all the paths, the quality of service constraint should be able to satisfy. So, one important part here is the tree construction, the multicast tree construction. And essentially, if we look at the various tree construction algorithms that exist, two types. One is the source based tree construction, where these algorithms initiate construction from each source and then reach the destination. And there can be a core based algorithm also, several core based algorithms exist, where the core is first formed in the network, which satisfies the required quality of service, and then the receivers join the core. So, we will not discuss a specific algorithm, because there are large number of algorithms exist which are being used. We will, if you are interested, you can look at specific algorithms, but they will fall into these categories. So, we'll stop here and we'll continue on our discussion about how the quality of service is being provided in a wide area network situation, and especially in the internet. Okay, thank you.